NASA is scrambling. At stake is the development of a new generation spacesuit for its projected 2025 mission to return human beings to the moon. Though NASA is a name that's been synonymous with advanced technology, its current spacesuits are ill-fitting, cumbersome, and equipped with antiquated technology that dates back to the 1970s, developed in partnership with a division of Playtex, a company known more for bras than space exploration. More on this in a bit.
Look, Mom, no hands!
One of the serendipitous consequences of the space race and all the technology that went into it was a slew of applications including GPS, freeze-dried food, water filtration bottles, skin cream, ear thermometers, jacket insulation, foam mattresses, and much more. Ironically, spacesuit technology has been lagging behind the aspirations of the US and NASA specifically to reopen the lunar frontier as a research base and gateway to Mars and beyond.
To infinity and beyond!
Speaking of infinity, that's where I'm trying to take this channel. So help me get there by subscribing and also liking this video. To date, NASA has spent approximately $200 to $400 million on the development of a new spacesuit. This resulted in this prototype demo back in 2019. But this particular suit appears to be gathering lunar dust somewhere on the dark side of the moon, because it hasn't been seen since.
So one of the things we've looked at is trying to reduce the space here, make a smaller unit, display and control unit here, and get those shoulders to where she has a lot more mobility to move. So she's able to do a cross reach and get across the suit, as well as reach overhead, which they can't do today and couldn't do during the Apollo program. Then in addition to that, we also, because this is the first time we've gotten to build a suit specifically for a planetary surface, we have a lot more mobility in the lower torso. So we have a waist bearing, and we have three bearings on the legs, as well as a flexion extension joint here at the waist.
NASA has apparently moved on and solicited the private sector to assist in its endeavors, awarding contracts to Axiom Space to design a suit for moonwalking. Another contract was awarded to Collins Aerospace to develop a separate suit for more general spacewalk activities. Before we delve into where this is headed and the likelihood of NASA meeting its deadline for the Artemis launch in 2025, let's rewind a few decades to 1966. This was the year that Thomas Stafford and Eugene Cernan orbited the Earth during the Gemini 9A mission. Cernan came quite close to death during his extravehicular activity, or EVA spacewalk. Pressurized to 3.5 psi, the G4C suit that Cernan wore became so rigid, Cernan described it as having the flexibility of a rusty suit of armor. He began to overheat, his visor fogged up, reducing visibility to near zero, and his heart rate rose to the 150s as he tumbled about, at times out of control, with his umbilical as his only tether to life. Overcome with fatigue and pain, Cernan had to abandon a planned test flight of the Astronaut Mobility Unit, a jetpack system that NASA had developed. Aside from the poor mobility issues, one of the other problems with the G4C suit was that it was air-cooled. This made for an inefficient system which allowed for the buildup of condensation due mostly to heat and sweat. The resulting fog on the faceplate would turn the astronaut into a blind mole with the mobility of a fully armored dwarf.
I'm wasted on cross-country! We dwarves are natural sprinters!
Fortunately, by the time Apollo 11 launched, Neil Armstrong benefited from a new generation spacesuit, the A7L, that was the result of healthy competition between B.F. Goodrich, Hamilton Standard, Litton Industries, and Playtex. Yes, it was that Playtex.
Is it the dress, or is it my figure?
Honestly, it's your bra.
My bra?
The bra and girdle manufacturer, known for its Cross Your Heart line, received the contract mainly due to the suit of armor problem that Cernan alluded to. Sure, it would be easy to develop a juggernaut-type suit that could withstand the rigors of moonwalks, space debris, and radiation, but the problem was flexibility and movement. This is where Playtex excelled. The company used a combination of Lycra, Teflon, Nylon, Nomex, Mylar, Dacron, and Beta Silica filaments in its hand-stitched suit. In total, there were some 21 layers of protective materials, which, when combined with the primary life support system, or life support backpack, weighed roughly 80 pounds on Earth and about 13.5 pounds on the Moon, due to the Moon having about 1/6 the gravity of Earth. The A7L suit featured a liquid cooling system, minimizing the blinding condensation and overheating issue that Cernan experienced during his Gemini spacewalk. Most importantly, the suit was flexible enough that Playtex had one of its technicians play football in it while it was fully pressurized. In a flex move, the technician even dropped down and did push-ups.
Now drop down, give me 25 more for speaking out of line!
Neil Armstrong later remarked of the suit, "It was tough, reliable, almost cuddly." In other words, it was everything you could ask for in a bra, I mean extravehicular mobility unit. The suit is estimated to have cost about $100,000 in the 1960s, which is closer to $1 million today when adjusted for inflation. This was a small price tag relative to what the suit was capable of, namely keeping Neil Armstrong and his fellow astronauts alive when confronted by the multiple threats they encountered in the lunar environment. First, there was the temperature spread of 500 degrees. Positive 250 degrees in the sun and negative 280 degrees Fahrenheit in the shade. There's also the danger of radiation, which can be up to 1,000 times stronger on the Moon due to its relative lack of an atmosphere and weak magnetic field. Exposure to cosmic rays, particularly during coronal mass ejections and solar flares, can induce radiation sickness in the short term and genetic mutations leading to cancer in the longer term. But wait, there's more. The possibility of getting struck by micrometeorite hail, pieces of rock and metal that don't encounter much atmospheric resistance on the Moon and can reach speeds of 20 to 30,000 miles per hour. And finally, even the dust on the Moon can be deadly. The regolith, or blanket of lunar substrate, consists of sizable quantities of fine-grained silica, known in common parlance as glass. The lunar surface is covered with these sharp, abrasive glass particles that are extremely dry, cling to everything, and when inhaled, can cause temporary to chronic lung damage. The lunar regolith was said to smell like soot or gunpowder, quickly ate up the soles of space boots, and obliterated vacuum seals and equipment. In addition, the dozen astronauts who were on the surface of the Moon all developed respiratory symptoms, which took some time to resolve. The many layers of the A7L suit were meant to protect its occupants from all of the perils mentioned above. Future iterations of spacesuits will need to do the same, if not more, as future moon missions may entail longer EVAs and therefore more dangerous exposures. In 1971, for the Apollo 15 through 17 missions, NASA began using the A7LB suit, which featured a few more joints for improved mobility, as well as life support systems that contained a larger volume of oxygen for longer excursions. Waste collection, however, was still managed via a containment system, essentially pouches taped in the appropriate locations. In 1981, however, NASA introduced a new spacesuit called the EMU, or Extravehicular Mobility Unit, which was fitted with a maximum absorbency garment, MAG, essentially a heavy-duty diaper. The suit was not a significant departure from the previous generation, which was still a collaboration of the Playtex parent company and Collins Aerospace, the makers of the life support pack. This suit was used on all shuttle missions throughout the 1980s and aboard the International Space Station, where it was made more modular to allow adjustable sizing for different crew members. Of the original 18 EMU suits, only 11 are still intact and fully functional. To be clear, we have been discussing extravehicular suits, which are meant for spacewalks and moonwalks. These are different from the intravehicular suits, which are much lighter and intended for the more hospitable environment within spacecraft. This is why the crew of SpaceX excursions appears so much more mobile and less encumbered than Armstrong et al. In addition to this, the Falcon 9 crews have SpaceX suits designed in a bespoke fashion, tailored to their shape, size, and physical dimensions. Jose Fernandez, who designed costumes for Black Panther, The Avengers, and Iron Man, was tapped for the project and was responsible for the sleek and fitted appearance of the final product. It is constructed of materials like Kevlar and Nomex and features 3D printed components, air power connections, microphones, and a retractable visor. As cool and sleek as these spacey tuxedos appear, they are not suited for any kind of moonwalk, nor were they intended to be. The Artemis mission suits might take some fashion cues from the SpaceX suits with their stormtrooper vibes. But the new suits will need to be designed not just for aesthetic appeal, but more critically for extended extravehicular activities, including the manned Artemis 3 flight, which will return, quote, man to the moon for the first time since Apollo 17 in 1972. It remains to be seen whether Axiom Space will be up to the task of completing and testing the spacesuit in time for the 2025 lunar landing. Thanks again for watching. And if you learned something new, make sure to like, go ahead and subscribe, and check out my other videos.